Three seats.
World-class cricketer or first-class cheat? Tonight, the Lion of Pakistan faces the Devil's Advocate. I am the Devil's Advocate, and tonight Imran Khan, Pakistan's former cricket captain and one of the world's finest all-rounders, is here with me in the studio. Welcome, Imran.
Thank you.
In May this year, a new book about Imran was published by Ivor Tennant, the Times cricket writer. It caused a storm. In a paragraph on page 134, Imran tells his biographer how he once used a bottle top to scratch a ball during a county cricket match in an effort to make the ball swing through the air. He admits that this was wrong, but maintains that it was a one-off and was a bit of a joke at the time. Imagine that. Perhaps worse, he admits that in the course of his illustrious career, he occasionally lifted the seam and scratched the ball with his fingernails. With these throwaway admissions, Imran has refueled a controversy that those of us who are the admirers of the resurgence of Pakistani cricket had hoped was burnt out. Throughout the 1992 summer series in England, the papers were stuffed with speculation. Pictures like these strengthened the allegations. Bowlers Wasim Akram, Wakil Yunus, and Akib Javed, it was alleged, were just too good to be true. Surely they must be doing something with the ball.
Oh, steady on.
While the storm raged, the one Pakistani no one could have called a cheat leapt gallantly to the defense of his countryman, Imran Khan. And so he should. The British press, he stated, could not stomach defeat in cricket at the hands of their former dark-skinned colonial subjects without whinging. But the irony is that just as the controversy was dying away this year, it is Imran's own revelations that have given it new life. The press have had a field day. The resulting image of Pakistani cricket and even the Pakistani nation been sorely damaged. Imran, may I read you something from your own autobiography, published in 1988. Once when I was 13, I was stopped by the police while driving my father's car. I knew I was driving without a license, so I bribed the policeman and got away with it. The chauffeur reported the incident to my mother. She was furious. She felt stooping to bribery was a real loss of dignity and that I should have gone to jail instead. I tried to defend myself by saying that other boys of my age had done the same in similar situations. Her answer was brief. You are a Pathan. In her eyes, that was synonymous with pride and honesty. 30 years later, Imran has used the same defense for ball tampering as he did when his mother found out he bribed a policeman. Everybody does it. It's an argument that did not wash with his Pathan mother, and it does not wash with the Devil's Advocate. And I'm forced to question not just what he did, but why he revealed it. This is my case against Imran Khan, and I'm going to pursue the case for the next few minutes or so. Imran, what strikes me now, if you did all of that, your career was finished, you were a member of the ICC, you soon would be managing the Pakistan cricket team, all that was before you. Why didn't you keep your mouth shut? That's what concerns me now.
Mm-hmm. Well, there were two reasons. One was, there are two statements there. One is the bottle top, which is a separate statement. The other is the scratching and the seam lifting. Now, the bottle top was a simple thing. He asked me a simple question that, have you done anything illegal? After I told him that I'd scratched and lifted the seam, but didn't think it was illegal. Mm. But when he talked about the, anything illegal, I said, yes, I once used a bottle top. Now, when I admitted to the bottle top, I genuinely didn't think. Knowing what happens in cricket, I did not think it would become such a big issue. Because what happened was that I just somehow miscalculated that the press would pick it up and use that as a packy bashing exercise.
Imran, you are surprised that they did
it? I'd never thought that one admission in a county match, if I ever used a bottle top, I never in my wildest dreams thought it would become such a big thing. Some people think it was for money. I mean, who wants a publicity to be called a cheat? Money, I have no financial stake at all in the book. The only reason was cricket was over for me. It was behind me. And not living in England, actually, because now I spend all my time in Pakistan, I actually did miscalculate.
Imran.
And the other thing about, the ball tampering I was talking about, the reason I admitted to that was because I wanted the issue to come out because I think it's very ambiguous. The laws are ambiguous.
Why didn't you raise it at the ICC quietly with them and say, look, we have done it. Let's change this law because it's a waste of time. Why didn't you do that? Why put it as a throwaway remark in a book?
But, let me explain to you. When I gave this interview, it was the height of the ball controversy because it was an Adam Lamb, Sarfraz Nawaz court case going on where every day I read packy cheats. And that is the reason why I gave that interview. Because in fact, when I said all this, my point was that this ball tampering, which Pakistanis are being accused of, has been going on throughout cricket history without anyone at all caring.
The whole thing is that in the heat of the moment, you opened your mouth, these words flow out. And so, is that it?
I'd written already 2-3 articles in the Telegraph saying exactly the same thing, except I hadn't named myself.
All right. When you bribed the policeman and you said that you did it because everybody did it too, your mother said you were Pathan. What was she trying to convey to you? What lesson she was trying to teach you?
A lesson that if everyone does it wrong, you don't do the same thing.
And you haven't learned that lesson properly, have you?
Yeah, well, let me start from...
No, answer me, and then you
can... I'm trying to answer it.
Yes, all right.
You see, when I said that I scratched and lifted the seam, I did not think that that was cheating. I didn't think that that was wrong. And the reason I say that is because within acceptable limits, these had become accepted practices. They were accepted practices because, now let me explain it's a little technical. What is seam lifting? Seam lifting in my time, if you lifted the seam above the normal, above the normal level of the seam was considered cheating. And that was amongst cricketers. Umpires could also only tell that you had done something wrong with the ball if the seam was lifted above the normal. But if you restored the seam, in other words, once the seam had got flatter, from one side, and you just restored it to the original level. Throughout my career, that was accepted as part of cricket. It wasn't considered cheating. It was considered legal, and I've seen everyone do it. And it had just... I did not consider myself doing something wrong.
Law 42.4 states, a player shall not lift the seam of the ball for any reason. That is absolutely clear.
Yeah, but this is exactly what I'm trying to tell you. That's why these things have to be redefined. If that's Law 42, and there's also another one of the oldest laws in cricket, 1787, was that the sole judge of fair and unfair play on the cricket field is the umpire. Surely, in 21 years, some umpire should have told me that you're doing something, me or anyone else. Because obviously, I've seen spinners stand in front of the umpire and lift the seam, just to get a better grip. I've never seen anyone stop, and this is in England.
Are you saying as a senior cricketer and the captain of Pakistan, you didn't know of Rule 42.4?
No. this is exactly what I'm trying to tell you.
You knew you were breaking the rule.
There is a diff. No. Rules are, for instance, I mean, if you're driving at 75 miles per hour in a 70 mile limit, you know, the people, if over a period it becomes practice. People, you know, there are certain laws that become practice and then therefore become null and void. And therefore.
Like bribing policemen.
Yeah, but practice. You know, bribing policemen is still different. You are actually doing something wrong. I did not think. I mean, this is, you know, the perception you must understand. What is the perception? Mm. My perception was it was an accepted part of cricket. I was no different to anyone else. Bowlers tried their best to get as much advantage as they could from the ball. And, you know, I neither did I consider anyone else cheating, neither did we complain about other people, nor ourselves, and we just thought it was part of cricket.
Imran, my friend, you are not an ordinary cricketer like anybody else. You're not an ordinary trundler like 90% of the people who bowl in county cricket. You're one of the finest bowlers of the game and known to be a discoverer of talent, somebody who nurtures talent, somebody who's able to nurture honesty in players and develop them. You had known for that, so you're not ordinary. Why, in that sense, didn't you obey the law and not carry on like every other commonplace cricketer that runs around county cricket every single week? You are special.
You know, when you bribe someone, it is actually you are breaking a certain law.
You know, when you lift something, the seam, you are as well.
When you lift the seam, the time we, you know, it's what my own perception is. Yeah. Time weeks, we thought we were breaking the law is if you actually lifted the seam above the normal level where it really stood up. For my, you know, as far as I was concerned, I never did that. And so I was in my own mind, and as far as I'm concerned, I was within the laws.
Let me read another law to you. You said you occasionally scratched the ball. Let me read another law to you. Law 42.5. Now, any member of the fielding side shall polish the ball. No one shall rub on the ground or take any other action to alter the condition of the ball. Scratching it is to alter the condition, isn't it?
Well, you see,
Dr. And the law is clear.
It doesn't say scratching the ball on the law, does it?
No, any other action. Any other action.
You see,
you could rub it.
Let me. The way I looked at this law, you know, yeah. When I said I scratched the ball, mm-hmm. I mean, you know, as far as I'm concerned, the condition was, and what is the umpire looking for is you're not altering the condition of the ball. Therefore, if the ball is already old, mm-hmm. if the ball is rough, okay, mm-hmm. you're shining one side, and this is when, you know, it's sort of 50, 60 overs old, when you're trying to get reverse swing.
Yeah.
You're shining one side, you know, to keep the resistance on the, and it's already old.
Mm-hmm.
When I thought that it was ball tampering was when a smooth surface of the ball you try and roughen up. Mm. But if the ball is already rough and you're maintaining the roughness, you know, I mean, occasionally you make sure that it doesn't get smooth, the things that are standing up, you know, for instance, if the ball is really rough, to me, that is not tampering with the ball because I'm not changing the condition of the ball. It happens, you see, by hitting the outfield at times, you know, there's a rough side, you know, it might get smooth.
Yeah.
So, you know, the way I look at it, if you just occasionally, and the word occasionally is very important here, you know, I mean, you don't keep scratching it, you occasionally. And the point is that you're not,
Or occasionally send for a bottle top.
Bottle top, I said very clearly, that is what I considered illegal. And for me, that's why I admitted to the guy that there was one occasion in my career where I did do something.
You see how difficult it has become, don't you? You see it.
You see, the thing is, I feel...
Even from sympathetic people.
No, I don't quite agree with you because, you know, your perception is still that, you know... I mean, what is illegal? It is in the mind that you are actually doing something wrong.
Imran, you are a graduate from one of the finest universities in this country. So I'm not going to take that from you. What is illegal is contravening 42.4 and 42.5, and they are abundantly clear. Absolutely clear. Don't lift the seam, don't do anything. So it is not a question of your perception. This is it. It's in black and white.
If you take that law as strictly as you want to be, you know, I doubt if there are any bowlers in the world who you won't end up accusing of cheating. So what I'm saying is, look, when I'm growing up, I have ideals. I'm not going to name these guys. I watched them do it.
Not
this
name
is all
them.
Accepted part of cricket.
I'm talking about the guns, big guns that you lined up with. Botham, Marshall, Lilly, Hadley.
Hadley?
Tell me which of them.
No, let me. Marcus, let me just clear this now.
Because why don't you tell me which of them?
You see, the point is, if you tell people in this atmosphere, you try and tell them that, listen, you know, so-and-so lifted the seam, you know, they think, no, every sportsman hates being called a cheat, and they'll think, you know, I'm accusing them of cheating. In fact, I never considered them as cheats.
I just want to press you a bit. Please, don't get angry with me, yeah? Because this is a debate. Did Malcolm Marshall, Anna, I'm a West Indian, tell me something. Did we call him Mako? Did Mako flick a seam, you think?
Well, you know, I don't
because
want
he used
to name
to, he used him. To swing it. He swung it.
Great bowler.
He swung and seamed it. You Both. Think he touched the seam or flicked the fingernail and stuff?
You know, if you have a look at some of the old footage.
I'm going to.
You know, that might be a revelation to you of most bowlers. I mean, all you have to do is watch them walking back.
Uh-huh.
You know, I think the very interesting exercise would be take over a period of time, just watch bowlers walking back. How many bowlers during the course of their career have not touched the seam?
All right, let's go on. If a seam bowler lifts the seam to aid movement off the wicket, why should it be such a big crime, I'm quoting you from the Telegraph, after the World Cup? Why should it be such a big crime for a swing bowler to enhance his swing by scratching the ball? You wrote that.
Mm-hmm.
Who are you referring to? Who are these swing bowlers who were enhancing their swing by scratching the ball?
Well,
you just come out of the World Cup, you won it.
Myself?
You would do it. Wasim?
You know, why name any bowlers? I'm just telling you that this is these sort of things have been going on.
No, this is something else.
Let's put this, that I'm not going to name names because I've told you the reason.
No, but we can't.
But I'll tell you, I did it.
We're coming to brighter times. This is a little difficult, I know, but don't worry. You've just come out of the World Cup, and it is as though something is weighing heavily on your conscience, because nobody asked you to write it, and you wrote, why should it be such a big thing? And if I could insert a few words, if Waka, Wasim and myself enhance our swing by scratching the ball. That's how it reads, you know.
The whole controversy actually started in the summer when Wasim and Waqar were getting wickets in England. That's when I wrote that article.
But you weren't playing.
No, I wasn't playing, but I mean, that's what I wrote.
But you weren't referring to yourself because you weren't playing. These guys were doing it, weren't they?
No, I can only talk about myself, okay? And I know that I never considered it that if the ball was already rough, I'm not talking about roughening up a smooth ball. I'm talking about if the conditions had already made a ball rough.
Mm-hmm.
If occasionally you scratch the ball, I never thought it any more of a crime. In fact, much less of a crime than lifting the seam, which is specifically mentioned in the laws.
Yeah. Okay. I don't think we could pursue that any further except to say that I would like you to admit that as captain of the team, if you are scratching it, and the leader of the bowling fraternity on your team, it is absolutely inevitable that others will.
No, but this is Wasim debatable. No, but this is, again,
You brought those two along, didn't you? They came in your shadow.
But let me explain another thing to you, that, you know, in our country, a club bowler knows how to reverse swing the ball. You don't have to reach the test standard, you know. You don't have to get there.
Do they know how to scratch it?
Let me, but before we get on to the scratching, let me explain. You see, in our country, what happened, that organizations came into our cricket, okay, and they did not have their own cricket grounds. So about 4 or 5 grounds had a lot of matches played. This is when reverse swing was developed in our country. Because in the 70s, we had these organizations, few grounds had all the matches. As a result, they got completely worn out. The squares were worn out. I mean, if you had to survive as a seam bowler in those conditions, you had to be able to reverse swing it.
The final question is this, and everybody's asking this, and I feel very embarrassed to ask it, but I must put it to you. If you hadn't lifted a seam or scratched a ball, do you think you would have gotten as many wickets?
Yes. Because, you see, the other misconception is that, you know, by anyone who scratches a ball can get wickets.
Yeah.
I mean, I used to bowl for Sussex. The whole Sussex team knew I could reverse swing. When the ball used to be old enough, I mean, my captain would just call me and say, listen, what do you think, this will swing? And I would swing it. Now, the same, I would swing from one side, and there was Garth LaRue, Sussex at the time, South African fast bowler, Jeff Arnold, there was Ian Gregg. I mean, these, they were English bowlers or international bowlers bowling from the other end. Why could they not swing it? If it was as simple as that, that you scratch a ball and you swing it a yard, surely the other bowlers should have been swinging it too.
Thank you, Imran. I'll be coming back to you in the second half of the program. After the break, I'll be talking to some other interested parties. Welcome back. I am the devil's advocate, and tonight I'm moving it both ways to Imran Khan, former cricket captain of Pakistan. In part one, Imran has answered some of my questions. Now I'm going to hear from some other interested parties. I'd like to go first to Don Oslier. You have umpired in a lot of matches that Imran has played in for Sussex around the county ground and so on. Is Imran telling us the whole truth, you think?
As far as I'm aware, he's telling us the truth. He has come out with some revelations, and he's admitted certain things. I came into it with regard Imran when I realised that a little later in the date which he mentions in the book, I had sent to the Testing County Cricket Board a document pointing out certain matters in a match which I umpired in which Imran played.
When was that, and the match between what, Sussex and Warwickshire?
That was correct, yes.
Was that?
In August 1983.
What did your report say?
Would it help if I just read this brief letter which I sent to the Testing County Cricket Board?
What? Just a line or two about the ball.
On the matter, the Warwickshire second innings finished quite suddenly with Imran Khan taking the last six wickets in a very short space of time with some very accurate bowling. As my colleague and I left the field, I noticed that a piece of the ball was sticking up, and upon a closer inspection, it could be seen that this piece was the triangle of leather which joins the cross seam and quarter seam. The stitching did not appear to be frayed, but more as if it had been cut, and the piece, which was proud of the ball, was large enough to be able to hold the ball by it.
Imran, what say you?
Don, if you don't have proof of that, I mean, if I was doing it, if you don't have proof, that is a serious doubt on my credibility. You know, when I say that I picked the ball once is different, but when someone else comes around and says, no, he did it again, my credibility is affected by that. And you know, the whole
article... Imran didn't say you did that again. He said you removed the seam so completely that you could hold the ball by the piece of the
I'm sorry, Mr. Howe, I said nothing of the sort. I said nothing of the sort and wrote nothing of the sort. I brought out a certain matter which we had seen with the ball. I said that he had taken the last six wickets, he bowled 4.3 overs, he took 6 for 6, and he bowled 5 of them, and the other one was LBW, to know the facts, but I did not accuse him.
But why are you bringing
anything
it up if you're not wanting to say Imran did it? I mean, you bring it, you can't get away from it.
Hold on.
Courtney Ambrose got a lot of wickets against England, bowled out the whole team. But I don't know, did they walk off with a piece of leather holding it?
There's one point I also want to...
This is serious, Imran.
Yep,
you or didn't you? Answer me.
I tell you something, there's one point I want to
mention.
What happened was, I was recovering from a stress fracture of my shin bone. So I could only bowl 5-6 overs in the match. Now, bearing in mind that the whole Sussex team, including my captain, John Barkley, knew I could reverse swing the ball, he handed me the ball, which was about 80 overs old. It was a very old ball he handed me, and he only handed it to me, looking at the condition, knowing it was rough, and it would reverse swing. And the biggest point you must remember is, that's, you're coming back to your answer that, you know, if I hadn't done anything to the ball, would I have got wickets? That same ball was used by Garth LaRue and other bowlers were bowling from the other end. How come I cleaned up the tail 6 wickets? How come they didn't? They should surely have got 1 wicket at least. You know, it was an old ball. He handed me that when it was an old ball.
Okay, let's talk about old balls. The one that was changed at Lords, where Derek Murray was, you were the third umpire, weren't you?
Yes, Mr. Howe.
And Derek Murray was the independent...
That's correct.
...referee. What was the state of the ball, as you remember it? Or do you remember it at all?
Since I carried it in my pocket for half an hour before giving it to Mr. A.C. Smith, I should have remembered it.
You don't have it there. I thought you were taking it out. Now, tell us, what was the state of it?
It had certain scratch marks on it. Cuts. Well, I would rather say they were cut marks rather than scratch marks.
So that some instrument you are suggesting was used?
No, I'm not.
Well, you can't cut leather with fingernails.
No, but you can.
You can? I'll try. I'm playing for Channel 4 next week.
You have a ball there. Yeah.
So you were saying that ball was badly tampered with by the Pakistanis.
No, I'm not saying that at all.
Why is everybody scared to talk?
I'm not scared to talk.
Cricket,
that's why I'm here.
The whole cricketing establishment would collapse. If you're accusing Imran of ball tampering, say so.
I am not accusing Imran of ball tampering and never would.
Derek Murray. I want to go to Derek Murray. Dick, tell me, you were the independent referee, and I am puzzled by this failure to clarify. It's all obfuscated. It's all gloomy. What is the state of the ball of that match? Was justice done in that match?
Yes, I agree with Don. There were scuff marks on the ball. The problem was, as the independent arbiter, I was constrained to act within certain guidelines, needing basically an accusation and following the principles of natural justice to allow the accused to have a say. And in the circumstances, the umpires at that game were not prepared to push the matter through to any formal conclusion. And hence, the matter rests in a vacuum, so to speak.
In that instance, the Pakistanis weren't given natural justice, in your view?
Well, in the circumstances, they were, because they were never accused of anything, except by innuendo.
Let me go to Sir Geoffrey. Geoffrey Boycott, one of the finest openers in the world. And we have a world-class team here, I think, a portion of it. Sir Geoffrey, tell me, why is... These accusations come out in the press. The officials are always very quiet about it. Nobody accuses anybody of anything. It's all innuendo. And this is this huge grey area. Why is that?
I think there's a fear of libel or slander, either way. I think that's the greatest fear, by people not naming everybody, so they're actually doing it by innuendo. And whenever you get criticism by innuendo, you're damned by it. You can't answer back. You know, it's only when you're accused properly, then you can give a proper answer, and that's the biggest problem. And the English press at that time, and certainly, were looking for opportunities to get at Pakistanis, and Imran calls it Paki bashing, and that stems through a number of incidents that have happened over a period of time with Pakistan and English cricket. Nobody made much of Derek Pringle's statements in the Telegraph at the end of his career last year when he retired, and said he'd done all these things to the ball. It's no big deal because, A, he's white, he's Essex, he's not that good.
It does seem whatever Pringle does to the ball, nothing much will happen. but I want you to keep going, Sir Geoffrey. So are you agreeing with Imran, and in a sense, there are others too, who believe that there is a sense of discrimination against the Pakistanis, unfairly so?
I felt so at the time. I mean, certain points that Imran makes, I agree with. One of the points you make is fundamentally correct. The laws are written as such that anybody who picks the seam in any shape or form, whether it's spinners, who I've seen just lifting it a touch to get a better grip, seam bowlers going right round the seam with the thumbnail to raise the seam up, using Lipsil to make it swing, using sun cream mixed in with their sweat, doing that, and it looks all inoffensive, but it's still, you know, it's still not right.
Are you sympathetic to Imran, even though he has admitted breaking the law?
Yes, I'm sympathetic to it because I've seen it done by a lot of players. I've been in teams myself, and don't ask me to name players because I'm not going to, so you're wasting your time. And I understand Imran's reason why, because it's a very emotive subject. Somebody's going to say that Imran called him a cheat, or I called him a cheat, and you can't know that. We've got libel, we've got slander, we're going to be in courts of law and everything. but I can put my hand on my heart. I've seen players in my own teams I've played with, and it became an acceptable practice. Wrong, they all knew it was wrong, else they wouldn't have been doing it, you know, secretively.
Yeah, yeah.
But they do it like we all do when we drive our cars. We go 75, 80 mile an hour, if we can get away with it, a bit quicker, 90, and then one day the policeman catches us, and you're done, well, aren't
let
you?
Let me go to the only American who has ever written a book on cricket, Marcusi. What is your response to the attitude of the newspapers to the Pakistanis and the general feeling that Pakistanis are not to be relied upon? What's your view about that?
My view of that is that it is racist and nationalist, and that this is one of those times when C.L.R. James' motto, "What do they know of cricket who only cricket know," is very appropriate. You have to look at this in a larger context. The papers, as Geoffrey Boycott has said, were out to get the Pakistanis in the summer of 1992. Anyone who goes back and looks at the papers from that period can't be in any doubt of that. And the history of bad feeling between English and Pakistan cricket goes back many years. The ball tampering only emerges in that context, and you can only understand it in that context.
Where's Jonathan Barnett? He is the manager of Waka and Wasim. How do you respond to the revelations and the furore that has been caused?
I don't put it down to Imran. He's got a point of view. We may not necessarily have wished he brought it out, but now that it's out, I mean, what we can say is that Wasim and Waqar have never been accused by anybody actually for cheating.
How do they feel about that?
They're very hurt. They're very upset, and they're entitled to be. Innuendo.
Upset with whom?
With the press.
Are they upset with Imran?
No. Mm. They're not upset with him at all.
For saying it at all?
No. Why should they be?
Okay. Sadiq Mohammed, former Pakistani player, what is your response to the fact that Imran has said these things and all of this, these problems have been thrown up into the air?
First of all, I would say that he is a man enough to make a decision and admit that, you know, he is admitted that the ball tampering has been going on and he's done it himself. What I'm saying that he did not visualize the effect or the damage it will create to the country and to the Pakistan cricket. That is where I think he did not do his homework properly, that Pakistan cricketers have been told by the media been casted as cheat. Now, by his statement, that has proved that the Pakistani bowlers were doing it.
Yeah, I want to answer that.
Okay, yeah, hold on. Let me go to some young players and
let,
we'll
let
take.
Me answer
no,
that.
I'll bring you in a minute, Imran. Tajbak, yes. What has it affected you in any way?
Well, my main concern is that, obviously, as Bash said earlier, that Imran's been a fantastic role model to young people. But I've actually seen personally myself boys, 12, 13, 14-year-olds, actually getting hold of a ball and scratching it. And that worries me. Because obviously people like Imran, they have a responsibility to these young people. And when they do make these comments, and obviously there's been a lot in the press as well, the young people are naturally going to try to copy their idols.
You must take these comments seriously.
Well, let me answer it first. Mm. I mean, that is one comment also why I regret having disclosed the bottle top thing. But here again, I did not think that the press would have exploited it against Pakistanis. I mean, Derek Pringle did it. Is Essex team a cheat? Is England cheats? I mean, you know, he said the same thing. Was that exploited?
Now, everybody did it, Imran.
Hold on. I want to just answer this question. Now, when I made these statements, Pakistan were being called cheats, all sorts of names in the press already. Now, how do you take this? Do you take this lying down and accepting it? Do you accept that, you know, someone is calling you cheats and you think he's gone quiet, now I should, you know, not stir up anything?
Okay, this is the final question before we close the show. If you had the opportunity to go back in time, with the knowledge of the consequences of what you said, would you say that again?
I would not have mentioned the bottle top incident, but I certainly would have said it about lifting the seam and scratching the ball. as accepted practices, widespread, and unless and until you now redefine it, like in baseball, similar sort of when there were ball tampering accusations, there were laws were made all the time to redefine them.
Close. Thank you very much, Imran, for coming and for your wonderful contribution. Imran Khan. Have Imran's admissions seriously diminished his standing as one of the world's greatest cricketers? Let's look at the evidence. Against Imran Khan, there are those who seem to imply that his transgressions may go further than he would have us believe. And some of his compatriots have expressed disappointment at the recklessness of his admission. And speaking for Imran Khan, others maintain that he has done no more wrong than many other cricketers. They say the Pakistani team has again fallen victim to age-old prejudices. Imran Khan, you have defended your case eloquently. I have grave reservations about the wisdom of your admission, and your countrymen have clearly suffered as a result. Nevertheless, the degree of criticism you have received seems to me to be more concerned with off-the-pitch politics as opposed to what's on the pitch and the proceedings of the game itself. You remain, in my view, one of the finest all-rounders in cricketing history. Thank you very much for coming. Thank you all, and good night.
While he was doing it, and I had to call him Daddy. He was a bit of a goer for his age.
She's lying. These are all lies.
He has a scar right here on his hip.
War now for a special witness profile of Imran Khan's life after cricket. Imran Khan at home in Lahore only a few weeks ago at his nephew's birthday party. Despite his retirement from world-class cricket, he remains a superstar. Imran has challenged the complacency of Pakistan's ruling elite, and despite his aloofness from official politics, has become an important player in the country's political life. Marriage at this stage was an abstraction, or so it would have seemed.
For 10 years, people have been asking me in Pakistan to get married. And such an obsession with it. So, yes, I said, look, after the hospital is completed, I will get married. Obviously, I would like to marry a Muslim. And what nationality, race, color, for me doesn't matter, because in Islam, there is no such thing as race or nationalism or, you know, these are just imposed by culture on us, but Islam gives us freedom. I mean, I could, as a Muslim, marry a Christian or a Jew either, but I would much rather marry someone of my faith only because I think you have a much greater chance of making it a success if two people's values, ideas, ideology are the same and you're going in the same direction in life and you're growing at the same pace.
Then Imran astounded everyone by marrying Jemima, the daughter of billionaire James Goldsmith. Press reaction in Britain was frenzied. Had the born-again Muslim abandoned his principles?
It would have been much easier for me to marry a Pakistani girl. But life doesn't go as we plan. The plan that prevails is of the Almighty. And so here I am, marrying a girl who is from a completely different background, but shares my vision. Much more, she shares my vision, my aspirations, my values. And so that's why I'm married to her.
In Lahore, he is the man who promised to build a cancer hospital and delivered. Ordinary people greeted the news of his marriage with relative calm.
ਉਹ ਬੜਾ ਅੱਛਾ ਕੰਮ ਕਰਦਾ ਪਿਆ ਉਹ ਨਹੀਂ ਮੈਂ ਸੁਣੀ ਉਹ ਨਹੀਂ ਮੈਂ